Yes, as the excitement just continues to build and build and build in this here tabernacle, in this here office. I don't think I've ever been as excited as I am now as it pertains to what I'm seeing in these scriptures. It's quite remarkable. And I'm just seeing more and more confirmations as I go through. Not a lot of rebukes, I've just seen a lot of confirmations, and that's what I'm going to do today, because I now want to talk about the Godhead badly. I really, really now want to talk about this Godhead. But during my last video, I found myself just saying openly that I'm being led to think now that Zion is actually the throne, and the throne is the body of Christ. And I thought, you can't really just throw that out without actually putting down as to why you're being led to think this. So that's what I'm going to do today. And I sense this is going to be a quite difficult video to do, because when it comes to Zion, it becomes quite complicated and perplexed. And it's one of these classic situations where this scripture says this and this scripture says that. And it doesn't mean that they contradict, of course. It means that I just don't yet understand. But what I want to do today is put down why I'm being led to think these things. Things that I probably would have thought were quite outlandish a few months ago. But it's been building now for a few months. And it's all pertaining to this word mountain. That's where it all started. So Zion, first of all, it's, what is it? What actually is it in terms of here now on planet Babylon? There is one in that plate, that little sliver of land, that is the home of the little hats. But it's not that. I'm very, very settled now that it's got nothing to do with that, because that for me is not the land flowing with milk and honey, that's for sure. And it's not a place that I aspire to, not at all. I can't think of too many other places on earth I'd rather go less than that country. So it's not that. For me, that's not the promise. So in the scriptures, how many are there? Are there only one, or are there more than one Zions? Are there two, or are there three or more, or is there only one Zion? Because if there's only one, Hebrews 12 becomes absolutely, absolutely critical. Now, as I was doing that last video, it's absolutely started to absolutely pour with rain here. I'm just going to keep going and hope and pray that it's not too loud. It's not too loud in the background. Now, as I was doing my last video, something occurred to me. Something occurred to me about the Word of God. And I thought, oh, I'm down at the park. I can't edit this. I can't edit this and go back and do it again, right? And that's part of the reason why I like to go down and do these videos down at the park. Just about our testimony. So the seed, the Word of God is the seed that's sown into our hearts. The spirit of prophecy is the testimony of Jesus, and our testimony is the testimony that the Holy Spirit gives us. So we testify of the Holy Spirit every time we share our testimony, right? And it just hit me. It just hit me like a ton of bricks as I was just watching through the final edit, the final run through of that video that I'm processing now, the one I did down at the park about the body of Christ being the Jews of heaven. It just absolutely hit me right between the eyes that the Word of God is actually our testimony. That's what's going on here. And I'll come into Revelation 12, and this just articulates it perfectly. So we've got the dragon being cast out of heaven. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ, the accuser of our brethren is cast down of our brethren, right? So we're now the Lord Jesus Christ brethren. We're now his friends, which accused them before our God day and night. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and loved not their lives unto the death. So the word of our testimony, and the Lord Jesus Christ, as he sends us in John 17, saying that he wants us to become one in each other, one with him, as he's one with the Father. He says that by their word, members of mankind are going to believe on his name. By the word of God of their testimony, and they overcame. Now the Lord Jesus Christ, be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. And we in the body of Christ, we overcome the world. We overcome the world by our faith. And faith only comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the word of God. The word of God, of course. The word of God, of course, being our testimony. So I read that and I thought, wow, wee. So I just had to start. I had to start with that today, all right? Now, as I put down this video, it's raining, it's cold, it's grey out there, it's certainly a winter's day, it's July 19, it's a Tuesday around about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, here on the New South Wales Central Coast, and I am up to Acts 16, and the testimony, the witness, the Holy Ghost. It's just come to life in a whole new way, Acts. Acts has been a book last few reads where it's all become just a little bit pedestrian for me, Acts. It's one that I don't get a lot out of. But this time as I search for purpose and just who the body of Christ are and the difference between the Lord Jesus Christ and his body, Acts 2 is most certainly start to come to life. All right, now, on the point of this video, so why was the man actually created? Now, God doesn't need anything from anyone, but he has created the man and he's created the creation. So that for me means that even though he doesn't need anything, that for me says that he has a purpose. He has a purpose for the man to be created. Now, we get this, we'll come back again, right? We come back again into Romans 8. Romans 8 at the moment, it's just absolutely everywhere. Those that are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. We've received the spirit of adoption because now we've been grafted into the olive tree. Members of the body of Christ, that body of Christ, I'm being led to think, this is what I'm putting down today, that the body of Christ is actually Zion, is actually the throne. Yes, it does seem quite strange, but I've been led to think this for a while, and that's why I'm doing this video. I just have to put this down. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. So the capital S Spirit, the Holy Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. So the Word of God, it beareth witness with our spirit, the spirit that's within us. So that's critical for me now. Does our spirit become the Holy Spirit? Do we get a new spirit, or is the old spirit translated? But the spirit itself bears witness in our spirit, the Holy Spirit that dwells within us, that being our testimony, the word of God that we get by faith, and faith only comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, that we are the children of God, right? The sons of God. The sons of God, the Lord Jesus Christ being the Son of God. I wasn't expecting this, but here we go, right? And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified. This word glorified, I'm going to get to this in this video as well. So for me, everything that the Lord Jesus Christ has inherited, the body of Christ is going to inherit, and our testimony, the word of God that dwells within us, testifies of the Holy Spirit that we are in fact the children of God, the sons of God, the joint heirs with Christ, right? And we're going to suffer with him, but we're also going to be glorified together. And this goes into Luke 1:52, which I'm going to talk about today as well, as it pertains to the thrones, the seats. He cast he's burned the mighty off their seats, and he's exalted them of low degree, those who have humbled themselves before the Lord, the children of God. Now get this, and we know that all things work together. So this, for me, because it's talking about the body of Christ, for good to them that love God. So this is talking about the body of Christ and all of those offices, all of those parts, the ligaments, all of it work together for the good that them that love God. So this is the habitation of the Spirit of God in a building fitly framed together, right? The habitation of God. That's what I want to talk about today. For good to them that love God, to them that are called according to his purpose. So the Lord God, he has a purpose. The Holy Spirit has a purpose for all of us in the body of Christ. So no, he doesn't need anything from anyone, but he most certainly has a purpose for the body of Christ. And just this next one, this is predestination, right? For whom he did foreknow, he did also predestinate to be conformed to the image of the Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. So it's just so interesting, this, because the Lord Jesus Christ is the firstborn among many brethren. But, for me, it's all about he, this here, right? So we get these two he's. For whom he did foreknow, right? So I see this now, and it's pertaining to verse 28. Those who have been called according to his purpose, those that love God, that's what we're talking about here. For whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son. he did also predestinate to be conformed into the image of his son. So it's talking about God, it's talking about the Father, but for me, it's talking about the body of Christ. He also did predestinate to be conformed in the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. So it's led me to think that this is talking about the body of Christ being the firstborn among many brethren. So it's just so multi-layered, all this, right? It's just blowing all my mind at this at the moment. I'm just new levels. I'm so excited. I'm just jumping out of my skin, and I've been saying on recent videos that I feel all dressed up and nowhere to go. And that's most certainly how I feel, but just being patient and resilient, and she'll be right. She'll be right. There's a purpose for the purpose, right? We've all been called. We've all been called for his purpose. Now, God, this is the thing with Zion. This is where it gets so difficult with Zion, because God is omnipresent. So God is everywhere. God is everywhere, right? And that's what I say before. If you just apply that, no, God doesn't need anyone, he doesn't need anything. If I just apply that to my everyday life now here on planet Babylon, I've got no purpose and I've got no point in getting up in the morning. If God doesn't need anything and God doesn't need anyone, well, he doesn't need me, he's got no purpose for me, so I give up, right? I give up. There's just no point in my life. But there is a point in my life. There's a purpose to my life. And that purpose is the purpose that God's called me for, right? So that the body of Christ have a purpose. Whether that translates into a need of God, I'm being led to think it potentially does. Because why would he do it? Why would he do it if he didn't have a need? For me, you only do something if you've got a need for it. You've got a purpose for it, and you've got a need for it. So I'm strongly being led to think that the Lord Jesus Christ has a purpose for the body of Christ, and I'm strongly being led to think that the Lord Jesus Christ also has a need for the body of Christ to exist. We're here because the Lord needs us to be here. The other thing is God is omnipresent. He's omnipresent. Now, right through these scriptures, this is what I'm going to put down today, that God dwells in Zion. He dwells in different places, but God's omnipresent, right? So God dwells everywhere, right? Now, again, you apply that and you think, well, I'll come into Acts, actually. This is the scripture I want to explain where I'm coming from here. So in Acts 2, very, very well-known scripture in verse 38, then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. So the Holy Ghost is actually a gift. God, the Holy Spirit, is omnipresent. But for you to have God dwelling in you, in your heart, in your field, on the farm, that's a gift. For him to dwell within us is a gift. And you only receive that gift if you believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's a gift. Faith is a gift. It's all a gift. So to have the Holy Spirit dwell in your heart, it's a gift. So now, if people don't have the Holy Spirit dwelling in their heart, they haven't received this gift, is God dwelling there? God being omnipresent. That's what I'm trying to establish here, right? So, no, God doesn't need anything or anyone. God is omnipresent, but God only dwells in those that fear his name and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that have repented and have been baptized. Matthew 22, we've got the Sadducees who are tempting the Lord Jesus Christ about the resurrection. And part of the Lord Jesus Christ's response, we get in verse 30, for in the resurrection, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are as the angels of God in heaven. So this for me goes to the promises that pertain to after this life. Not this life now, the promises after this life. And we get it again here in Matthew 19, where the Lord Jesus Christ tells them that in the regeneration, when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, ye shall also sit upon 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. A scripture I want to get to more on this video. But again, this goes to the promises that are in the future, not of this life. In Revelation 20, we get a manifestation of that where we've got the body of Christ sitting upon these thrones in the 1,000-year reign. So the body of Christ are taking part in the first resurrection so that the second death has no power. So the body of Christ have been gifted eternal life, and now they're going to reign with Christ 1,000 years. And then after that reign, we come into Revelation 21, where we've got the eternal city. So the promises to the body of Christ are intense to they that love him. Those who have been called according to his purpose, those who have repented and received the gift of the Holy Ghost, those that fear the Lord and those that believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. John 3:35 tells us that the Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. That tells me that everything that the Father has, everything that the Father is, has been given to the Lord Jesus Christ, because they're one. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, they're all one. So the Lord Jesus Christ has been given all things of the Father. Romans 8 is telling us that we also as children, so the Lord Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And in John 10, the Jews ask him, well, they tell him that because he claims that his Father is God, that he, as a man, he's making himself actually as God, the Son of God. This term, the Son of God, seems to make the Lord Jesus Christ God himself. So now the Lord Jesus Christ is the Son of God. The body of Christ are the children of God. And we also, of course, read in Romans 8 that the body of Christ are the sons of God. So if we're children, which we are, so if children, well, then we're heirs, because the Lord Jesus Christ is the heir. So we're heirs too, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. And then in Revelation 21:7, he that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. The Lord Jesus Christ overcame all things. The Lord Jesus Christ overcame the world, and we overcome the world by our faith. And we're going to inherit all things as the Lord Jesus Christ has been given all things into his hand, we as heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. So what else is a guy supposed to think? But I am not ready yet to say what is seemingly the case here. But the body of Christ, the difference, I ask the question again, what's the difference between the Lord Jesus Christ and his body? What is the actual difference? So I look at just myself here. I've got an eye. I've got two eyes. I've got a nose. I've got ears. I've got a mouth. I've certainly got a mouth. I've got arms, legs. I've got all the rest of it. So is my nose, it's a part of me, right? So what is me? What is you? Everything that is about you, and they make up you. So my nose, my eyes, my face, everything, my soul, my spirit, all of those things combined, being my body, make up me. So that leads me to think that every part of my body is in fact me, as I get closer and closer to saying what I am most certainly thinking. But it tells me that the body of Christ are going to be absolutely glorious. We're going to inherit all things. We're joint heirs with Christ. And the Lord Jesus Christ being the Son, that makes him equal with God, and it actually makes him God. And we're joint heirs, and we're also sons. So it tells me that the body of Christ are going to be absolutely glorious. The throne, Zion, the body of Christ. The point of this video, I'm being led to think that all three are in fact the same thing. Now, back in Romans 8:29, for whom we did foreknow, he did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn of many brethren. Now, as I say, I'm being led to think that this is pertaining to the body of Christ being conformed to the image of the Lord Jesus Christ, the body of Christ and his body being made one, as we're made one together, he and the Father being one, we being conformed into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, in 2 Corinthians 4:4, we read that the Lord Jesus Christ is the image of God. This is quite difficult today because my little marker thing, for whatever reason, it won't work. So it's very, very difficult this today, but we'll plow on and we'll navigate our way through this. The Lord Jesus Christ is in the image of God. Romans 8:29 is telling me that the body of Christ are being conformed into the image of his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, that he may be the firstborn of many brethren. But in 1 Corinthians 11, this one's interesting. For a man indeed ought not cover his head, for so much as he is in the image and glory of God. Now, is the man now? I'm not being led to think that at all, because we're going to bear that image due to the progression of faith. So whether this is pertaining to the creation, I'm not sure, because I'm not seeing that man right now is in the image of God and the glory of God. I'm not seeing that at all, not for 1 minute. But 2 Corinthians 3:18, it becomes an absolutely enormous verse, because we also see this word glory. But we all with open face beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord are changed into the same image. That image here. So we're being translated into the same image that the Lord Jesus Christ is in now, and he's actually in the image of God. Zion, the throne, and the body of Christ, the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. Now that word image, we get it the 23 times, an image, figure, likeness, an image of the things, the heavenly things. So right through this video, for me, I want to put it out there. I want to forefront in anybody who I'm blessed enough to have watched this video, just keep Hebrews 12, 22, 23 in the forefront of your mind right through this video, right? Because if there's only one Mount Zion, then it's heavenly, right? It's heavenly. The city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, Mount Zion. You're coming to Mount Zion, the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, right? Into the innumerable company of angels, an image of the things, the heavenly things. Used of the moral likeness of renewed men to God. The image of the Son of God into which true Christians are transformed is likeness, not only to the heavenly body, but also to the most holy and blessed state of mind which Christ possesses. So that's that scripture in Corinthians 2, bringing every thought into obedience and into the captivity of Christ, which Christ possesses, the image of one in whom the likeness of anyone is seen applied to a man on account of his power of command to Christ on account of his divine nature and absolute moral excellence. Now, the body of Christ are joint heirs. The body of Christ, they that overcome as joint heirs will inherit all things as the Son of God, sons of God, and the Lord Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and that makes him equal with God, and that indeed makes him God. This last one here, to Christ on account of his divine nature and absolute moral excellence. That word divine nature is leading me to think that it's heavenly. And that's what we're getting in these scriptures. The Lord Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God, and the body of Christ are being changed into that same image. So this video, I'm putting down why I'm being led to think that the body of Christ and Zion and the throne are exactly the same thing. It's quite clear to me now that the body of Christ when all of this is finished, are going to be absolutely glorious. In the same image of God, in the same image, well, the same image as the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm sorry, who's in the same image of God, the Lord Jesus Christ and the Father being one, the prayer that we become one in one another as we become one in the Lord Jesus Christ and the Father. We all become one as joint heirs. We all become one. Like, we all become one. God, Jesus, and man all become one. To me, that's absolutely mind-blowingly, it's absolutely mind-blowingly significant. Back in Romans 8:18, for I reckon the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. The glory that shall be revealed in us. So I'll actually go this word, I want to share quite a number of scriptures here, but I'll go to the meanings of the word now. So we get 168 times, glory, glorious, honor, praise, dignity, and worship. Now remember, in Romans, for I reckon the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. So that says it, that the body of Christ are going to be glorious. Now, what's that glory that's going to be revealed in us? It's our testimony of the Holy Spirit. That's how, for me, that's how the Holy Spirit's going to be glorified in us. It's by our testimony, the testimony of God that He's given us by faith. The Word of God, the seed, our actual testimony. For me, is the Word of God, the Holy Spirit that dwells within us, and that's that glory that's going to be revealed in us. So the body of Christ are going to be made glorious. In Romans 8:21, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. So we get it again, right? We get it again. Now, as I say, we get this one 168 times. Glory, glorious, honor, praise, dignity, and worship. So we get opinion, judgment, view. Opinion, estimate, whether good or bad concerning someone. And in the New Testament, always a good opinion concerning one result in praise, honor, and glory. So that seems to roll those two up and saying, well, it's an about an opinion. But in the New Testament, it's always positive. It's always a positive opinion, and it's always resulting in praise, honor, and glory. The image of God, right? Splendor, brightness of the moon, sun, stars, right? And I'll put this up now, actually. This is a good time. I got some footage just on my Huawei P20 Pro, and it was just on sunrise, and this is Sirius. Very, very fetching star. It's a very, very pretty star and very unique when I film it. You can see pulses of light coming off it. Bang, bang, bang. There's stuff going on around Sirius, right? Quite a star. Whenever I see a new star, I think, oh, that's new. I didn't see that yesterday. And there it was. There it was. A very fetching star. Very, very unique. And that's what we're looking at here. Splendor, brightness of the moon, sun, and stars. This is the glory that's going to be revealed in the body of Christ as children of God into the glorious liberty of the children of God. And this word gets even more exciting. So Mount Zion, the throne, the body of Christ, right? The dwelling place of the Holy Spirit, magnificence, excellence, preeminence, dignity, and grace, majesty, a thing belonging to God, the children of God, the kingly majesty, which belongs to him as supreme ruler, majesty in the sense of absolute perfection of the deity, the divine nature, right? The thing belonging to Christ, the kingly majesty of the Messiah, the absolutely perfect inward and personal excellency of Christ, the majesty, right? And we're going to be translated into this. Of the angels, as because the Lord Jesus Christ is the image of the Father, and we're going to be translated into the image of him, and we're all going to become one with one another. They're one with one another as we become one in them. as apparent in their exterior brightness, a most glorious condition, most exalted state. Of that condition, with God the Father in heaven, to which Christ was raised after had he achieved his work on earth. The glorious condition and blessedness into which is appointed and promised that true Christians shall enter after their Saviour's return from heaven. So there it is there, right? So the body of Christ are going to be absolutely glorious, one with Jesus, one with one another, one with the Father, all one. We all become one. Man become one with God. One. One. God's throne, the body of Christ, and Mount Zion, right? So it's a fascinating word, this one, and it's like, how far do I actually go here? Because there's a lot I want to put down. The one I wanted to talk about was, again, this one in 2 Corinthians 3:18. But we all, with open face beholding, as in a glass, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. Now, this is that scripture I shared before as it pertains to this word, image. So the Lord Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God. We're being conformed, we're being translated into that same image. And that word image, again, it pertains to an image of the things, the heavenly things, use of the moral likeness as of renewed men to God, the image of the Son of God into which true Christians are transformed to Christ on account of his divine nature and absolute moral excellence. So we're going to be transformed into that image as the Lord Jesus Christ is the image of God. That's that word there, image, and that's that word there, image, right? But we all with open face beholding as glass in the glory of the Lord are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord and the glorious gospel of Christ, right? That's what we're looking at. That's what we're looking at. The most glorious, glorious state you can imagine, the body of Christ. The body of Christ are going to be glorious. The body of Christ are going to be this, the glorious condition of blessedness into which is appointed and promised that true Christians shall enter after the Saviour's return from heaven, as we all become one, right? Now, where all this started for me, where I started seeing that mountains were actually thrones in the scriptures, was in this Hebrew word, H2022. I saw something, it may have actually been, just going on memory, it may actually been in Judges with Mount Heriz. It was that actually, yeah. It was pertaining to Mount Heriz, which is the sun, I got the impression, when you look at this word, Heriz, I got the impression, Ajalon, it's all coming back now. So Ajalon's where the moon stood still in Joshua. So Heriz actually means the sun. And in the Brown Driver Briggs, we get Judges 1:35, but the Amorites would dwell in Mount Heriz in Ajalon, and yet the hand of the house of Joseph prevailed, but they became tributaries. And it also gives us, and that's the scripture, it's the only time we see Mount Heriz, which is actually the sun itself. It means the sun, right? Mount Heriz. But we also get this one in Judges 8:13, and Gideon, the son of Joash, returned from battle before the sun was up. And it tells us from the ascent of Heriz, which is actually the sun. So I started to see it, that potentially that this is the mountain of the sun. Mount Heriz is actually the mountain of the sun. And when you see them come up and then they go down, the true cosmology of the earth, it's like they're ascending and they get to the midst of heaven in the middle of the day, well, the sun does, and then it descends down the mountain and then it sets, right? And that's what I started to see here, because we get from the ascent of Heriz and we get the son of Joash returned before the sun was up. It's like I started to see that potentially that it was pertaining, every celestial body potentially has their own mountain, has their own throne, and that's their ascent and their descent as we see it, as we see it on the earth. So that's what the, yes, my memory's been triggered here. That's what started me off with this word mount. Because when we come up into the Chaldee lexicon, it's quite lengthy and detailed. But we get this here as Sinai, as the abode of Jehovah, right? So in the Old Testament, and we also get the holy mountain of God, and these scriptures in Isaiah I'm about to share, man, that pertains to Ezekiel 28, it's just absolutely blowing my mind, right? Now, heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. So God, he dwells on his throne, right? That's where he dwells. He's omnipresent, but he dwells on his throne. Because he sits on his throne, that's where he actually is. And that's what we get in Revelation. All of those thunderings, lightnings and voices and all the rest of it, the seven spirits of God, for me, that's the actual heavenly body of Christ. They're the entities. They're the entities. That's the actual body of Christ. And that's how the Lord Jesus Christ has been manifesting right through the Old Testament. All of these voices, thunderings and lightnings that are coming forth out of the throne. So he manifested as a flame in the burning bush, for instance, in Exodus 2. The Lord Jesus Christ, the Word of God, all the way through the Old Testament. But we get Sinai as the abode of Jehovah, right? So he's living, that's his dwelling place. He's a mountain. Heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. And for me, Moses, when he went to see him, he most certainly went up to see Jehovah in heaven. There's scripture there. I'll put it up on screen. So Sinai, a mountain, is the abode of Jehovah in the Old Testament, the mountain of God. And he dwells on his throne. Now, when we come down further in the Chaldee lexicon, we get, I'll pick it up from, we'll go here, the Holy Land as being mountainous. So the Holy Land's mountainous, right? Because there's thrones there. We know there's 12 thrones. More often in plural, mountains of God, right? The mountains of God. And we get the Lucifer scriptures. Father, as to the religion of the ancients, especially of the Hebrews, who regarded mountains as holy and as the abodes of deities. Like, check that out. Check that out. So you consider what we just read in Judges 1:35. So the sun, I'm being strongly led to think the sun's a god. The sun rises down there. It goes up and it comes down just like the shape of a mountain. And we're getting that the ancients, especially of the Hebrews, they regarded mountains as holy and as the abode of deity. So the sun's a deity. And it abides on its mountain, which I'm being led to think could very well be Mount Heriz. It's ascent and descent. But the deities, what's a deity? A deity's a god, right? A deity's a god. So this word mountain, which I'll come back to in just a sec, the Hebrews, they're regarding mountains as holy. Mountains as holy and as the abodes of deities. We get the word planets once in the Old Testament. Hebrew word H4208. And it means constellations, signs of the zodiac maybe. I did a lot of videos on this a few months ago. And I'm just going to touch it on it all now. Now, I see this as in a sense of reigning. This is the Jews from heaven. So the Jews from heaven come down to mankind from the planets. A constellation, and this is Maseroth, the 12 signs of Maseroth, the 12 tribes of Israel, right? That's these planets. Because in the Chaldee lexicon, we get lodging places and inns of the sun. The Hebrews gave this name to the 12 signs of the zodiac, the 12 tribes of Israel, the 12 signs of Maseroth. And it's also the circle of palaces, which I'll get to in just a second, the New Testament. These were imagined to be I'm being led to think, because it's fact, the lodging places of the sun during the 12 months, and they rendered them to superstitious worship. The rabbins call them the individual signs and circle of them, right? So the circle of palaces, the 12 lodging places of the sun. 12. The 12, I see it as Maseroth. Now, in the Brown Driver Briggs, we get perhaps signs of the zodiac, but we also get the abode of gods. The planets are the abode of gods, right? So we come back to the word mountains, and the ancient Hebrews regarded mountains as holy and as the abodes of deities, the mountains, the abode of the gods, and that's what these planets are. That's what these constellations are. They being the lodging places, the 12 lodging places of the sun, the 12 signs of the zodiac, the circle of palaces. Now, the circle of palaces, we get this in the New Testament for me in Acts 17 with this word Areopagos, Greek word G697. We also get it as Mars's Hill, right? Mars's Hill. Now, I see this, and we get the apostrophe after the S. So this for me means it belongs to Mars. This hill actually belongs to Mars. I'm being led to think what we're looking at here is Mars's abode. Mars's actual abode, his planet. We're looking at Mars's mountain. So we've got Mars is the deity, but his mountain is called Mars's Hill, and that's Areopagos, because it means martial peak. Martial peak, a rocky height in the city of Athens opposite the western end of the Acropolis toward the west. Now, I'm not for one minute being led to think that this is a place in the Mediterranean today. Not at all. Not at all. I'm strongly being led to think that this is actually a celestial place, because check this out. This hill belonged to Ares, in brackets, who is Mars. So we look up into the sky at night and we're told that that red dot is actually the planet Mars, right? I'm being led to think that what we're looking at is not a planet. It's actually the deity. Mars's planet is the trajectory that we see it on when it's up during the night time. It starts at the base of its mountain, and then when it's at its zenith, it's at the peak of the mountain, and then it goes down the other side of its mountain every night when it rises and sets. Now, this hill, it actually belonged to Mars, and that's what I say in the scripture. The actual hill belongs to Mars. So that's where Paul is. So where Paul is here, I saw something in Acts this morning that just really leads me to think that the whole book of Acts was about getting the seven churches that we read in Revelation to come to repentance. That's what I'm starting to see. But in any case, this hill belonged to Ares, Mars, and was Mars's hill. So called because, as the story went, now this is where it gets a bit odd. Mars having slain the son of Neptune for the attempted violation of his daughter, was tried for the murder here before the 12 gods as judges. So that's what I say. It's quite odd, because this is actually his own hill, but this is where he was tried for this attempted violation. But it's his hill, right? But there's 12 gods here as judges, right? There's 12 gods. So there's 12 planets, 12 lodging places of the sun, there's 12 tribes of Israel, and there's 12 thrones. I'm being led to think 12 mountains, 12 hills, and that's what we also get in the Chowdhury lexicon for that word mountain, that the Holy Land is actually a mountainous, it's actually a mountainous country. So we've got Mars's hill is one of these hills, and that's where they are here, and they convene before these 12 gods as judges. So I'm being led to think that this is actually the congregation of the mighty in Psalm 82, they being the circle of palaces, this court here. We've got 12 gods as judges. We've got the circle of palaces. They're the 12 lodging places of the sun, they being the planets, they also being the abode of the gods, and that's what these mountains are as well. The mountains are the abode of the deities. I'm being led to think that the abode of the deities are these mountains, those mountains being these 12 gods, well, the 12 thrones, I'm being led to think these 12 gods are sitting upon, that being the circle of palaces, the abode of the gods. But for me here, we've got an abode of a deity, an abode of a god is actually a mountain. I'm being led to think that mountain, their actual throne. But back at this word mountain, this is what I forgot to put down. We see right down the bottom here, in proper names, Mount of the Sun. It's actually the Mount of the Sun. So the Charlie lexicon for this Hebrew word, H2022, for mountain, is actually telling us that we've got a Mount of the Sun, and check out the scripture it's actually pertaining to. Judges 1:35, right? So it's the Mount of the Sun. It's actually a city of, in brackets, the territory afterward belonging to the Samaritans. Judges 1:35. So it's the Mount of the Sun. So Judges 1:35 again is Mount Heriz, and it means the sun. The actual word for mountain, it's giving us the Mount of the Sun, as it gives us Judges 1:35, which is Heriz, the sun, a mountain in Palestine, Judges 1:35. But we get this scripture down here in Judges 8:13, and Gideon, the son of Joash, returned from battle before the sun was up. And the blurb gives us from the ascent of Heriz, the ascent of Heriz, which means the sun, and we're getting that it's actually the sun's mount. And that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm strongly being led to think we're looking at here. We're getting the sun going up its ascent of Heriz. It's mountain that we're getting here in the Chowdhury lexicon for this word mountain. So yeah, that I forgot to put that down. And that's what really, it was a couple of reads ago, that's really started to get my mind going just about what mountains are as it relates. I'm seeing now, as it relates to the planets, I'm seeing now that all the deities, all the celestial bodies have their own mountain, and that's their ascent and that's their descent when we see them at night time, but also during the day. That's actually their mountain. Now, I'm not being led to think that every time we read this word mountain in the scriptures, it's pertaining to celestial, not at all, because there's most certainly mountains on the earth as well. And that's the first time we get it. We get it as the high hills that were under the whole heaven. So the floods were upon the earth, and all the waters prevailed exceedingly upon the earth, and all the high hills that were under the whole heaven were covered. So I'm not saying that, no, not every time we see this word mountain, not at all, that it pertains to the celestial, but I'm absolutely being led. But that's what we get in the Chowdhury lexicon. We're actually getting the Mount of the Sun. So the Mount of the Sun, for me, that's just not on earth. And we get it again in Joshua 10, where some pretty well-known scriptures, where Joshua spoke to the Lord, and when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel, and he said in the sight of Israel, Sun, stand thou still upon Gibeon, and thou moon in the valley of Ajalon. Now the sun and the moon are celestial bodies. That's not open to discussion. They're celestial bodies. That's a closed case. So for me now, for the sun to stand still upon Gibeon, that has to take place in the celestial. So yeah, absolutely, I'm being led to think that Gibeon's a celestial place, and so is Ajalon. Because in verse 13, we get it. We get the sun stands still and the moon stayed. So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven and hastened not to go down about a whole day. Now the sun can't stand still and the moon can't stay in anywhere else but the heaven, in the firmament, in the celestial. It can't take place anywhere else. So this is the thing, because for me, I'm seeing now that the sun's planet is Mount Heriz. That's the sun's actual mountain. But it's standing still upon Gibeon. So it's actually in a different place. Now, whether this pertains to the 12 lodging places of the sun, and Heriz is one of them, and Gibeon's another, I'm not sure. But for me, these are most certainly celestial scriptures. We've got the sun and the moon standing still. And it's interesting because the moon's doing it in a valley. But the sun, it's happening upon Gibeon. So for me, there's no way these are earthly scriptures. For me, they just can't be, because it's talking about the sun. The sun cannot stand still upon an earthly mountain. For me, it can't happen. And the moon can't stand still in the inner valley of Ajalon on the earth. To me, they're most certainly celestial scriptures. And that's what I'm seeing here. There's no way. There's no way this is taking place on earth. It's, for me, it's just no way. It's not on earth. The mount of the sun, it's celestial. And we're actually getting the Hebrews, they're regarding mountains as holy and as the abode of deities. And that's what we get in the word for planets, that it's, they're actually the home of the gods, which I'm being led to think are the mountains. And it's interesting because right through the Old Testament, didn't they? That's what they did. They worshipped these, the sun, moon, and the stars, even all the host of heaven. That's what they did. So I'm being led to think that they were worshipping the gods and their planet and their mountain. That's what I'm saying. And that's what we get in the brackets down here. This would have much more to do with superstition and idolatry than with revealed religion. That's what I'm seeing there, that's what they were doing. Rather than going for the knowledge of the Holy Spirit, rather than trusting the Lord and fearing the Lord, they were worshipping the mountains, they were worshipping the planets, they were worshipping these strange gods. But in any case, we get in Exodus 3:1, we've actually got the mountain of God. So that's the thing. Is this actually the throne of God? Is there actually any difference? Because God dwells in heaven, and God most certainly dwells in Zion. This is what I said before. This is where this gets so hard, because God's omnipresent, but he only dwells with those that love him. That's what we get in Acts 2. So this is where it gets really, really difficult. God's omnipresent, but he dwells in Zion. And he dwells on his throne, and he dwells on his mountain. Is there any difference? I'm not seeing any. And I'll keep going to put down why I'm being led to think these things. The word mountain is Hebrew word H2022. We get it the 546 times, and we get it as mountain, mount, hill, hill country, and promotion. So that does potentially become significant too, because we see the word hill a lot in these scriptures. So I'm seeing potentially that the hills are also, it's also relating to this. As I think of that term, the high hills, we get that quite a lot in the scriptures as well. But on the surface of it, it looks to me just like it just looks like earthly mountains when you have a look at it. But the plot does thicken as I've been putting down. I'm strongly being led to think, this is what I say, is there a difference between Mount Zion, the body of Christ, and God's throne? Is God's throne actually Mount Zion and the body of Christ? I'm growing more and more of the view that that is actually the case as I do this video. Now, we get it a lot, so it's going to be hard to go through the whole word, which I'm not going to do, but it really, there's scriptures here in Deuteronomy and also in Isaiah that I'm going to share. Isaiah is where this really hots up, and that's where I'm going to be focusing a lot of the Old Testament with this now, because I'm not trying to understand per se as to whether mountains every time we see it are actually thrones. I'm trying to establish, I'm searching the scriptures to see whether this is so, as to whether God's throne is actually Mount Zion. That's what I'm trying to establish here. And we get a lot of scripture that gives me a greater idea about whether that is actually the case or not in Isaiah. So that's where I'm going to focus this, because otherwise I'm going to be here for just hours and hours and hours. And I feel this video is going to be long enough as it is. Now, in Deuteronomy, it's interesting because in 1:6, we get the Lord our God spoke to us in Horeb. So Horeb, just going on memory, it means desert. It seems to be pertaining to the desert. And that's Paul's allegory. That's Paul's allegory in Galatians 4, where we seem to have the two Jerusalems. Now, whether that's actually, there's two different Jerusalems as a place, or whether Paul's talking in allegory, where we've got the Jerusalem that gendereth to bondage, and then we've got Jerusalem, our mother, which is above and free, and or whether it's pertaining to an earthly Jerusalem and a heavenly Jerusalem, I don't know. This is what I say. Is there one Zion? Is there one Jerusalem? Is there more? I'm not settled. I'm not settled on it yet, not by a long way. And we've got God, he's most certainly got his holy mountain in the Old Testament. And in Deuteronomy 1:6, the Lord God spoke to us in Horeb. So this pertains potentially to the Old Covenant, because the question I've now got is the holy mountain the same mountain right through? Because the holy mountain in the Old Testament is Horeb. And in the New Testament, but also in the Old Testament, it's Mount Zion. So does God actually have two mountains, or is this the allegory Paul's talking about, where it's actually the same mountain and one's under the law and one's under grace? I'm not sure. But in Deuteronomy 1:6, you have dwelt long enough in this mount, in it. So they're actually in it. The children of Israel are in the mount. So are the children of Israel with God? With God, I just think about the tabernacle, the congregation, and that's the thing. Exodus 25:8, I'll share that now. Let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. So how is that different to the body of Christ today? Because the body of Christ today is the Lord's habitation by the Spirit. So he dwells within us. We're the building, we're the tabernacle, we're his sanctuary now, a dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. So in Exodus 25:8, is there any difference? The tabernacle, the congregation, the building. The building being the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. And ye have dwelt long enough in this mount. Now, in 1:19, we've got the mountain of the Abarites. Now, if this is actually a throne, which I'm being led to think it could be, the Amorites' actual planet, the Amorite, the celestial body, this then leads me to think that all nations potentially have their own mountain, their own throne. And we most certainly get it again with Mount Seir. But check out this one in Deuteronomy 3:25. This is loaded, and this is one of those moments where I'm just going to put it out there because I've done it in previous videos, where I'm just going to put it out there without going and establishing, because I'm trying to just establish that this, well, not establish, I'm trying to see whether these things are our say. What I'm trying to establish is why I'm being led to think this, why I'm being led to think that Mount Zion is the throne and it's actually the body of Christ. But I'm seeing that Lebanon is actually where Eden is. Eden is in Lebanon, and the Garden of Eden is actually in Eden, which is in Lebanon. So we've got that goodly mountain and Lebanon. So I'm being led to think that that goodly mountain could very well be Mount Zion, which is the Garden of Eden, potentially. Now, as I say, this really hots up here in Isaiah. We first get it in Isaiah 2:2, and it shall come to pass in the last days. So when's that? When's that? To me, that's when everything's finished. That the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow unto it. So this is absolutely and utterly loaded for me, because I'm seeing that the mountain of the Lord's house, this is the throne, This is Mount Zion, and the Lord's house is the body of Christ. So for me, we absolutely get it there. The mountain of the Lord's house. Now, when I say the body of Christ, I'm not saying right now, I'm saying the exalted body of Christ, the outcome of the progression of faith when all these things have taken the pass, come to pass in the last days, shall be established in the top of the mountains. So we've got multiple mountains going on here, right? Now in Matthew, the Lord Jesus Christ says you will sit upon 12 thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. The Lord Jesus Christ has his throne and God has his throne. And we've got this mountain, which I'm being led to think is Mount Zion, God's throne, the Lord's house being the body of Christ, shall be established in the top of the mountains. So it's the most holiest, it's the most exalted, and shall be exalted above the hills, right? So the body of Christ, I've just been putting that down, that the body of Christ are going to be exalted. The body of Christ are going to become absolutely glorious, exalted above the hills, and all nations shall flow unto it. And there's neither Jew nor Gentile. We are all one in Christ Jesus, right? That's how that reads to me. And verse 3, the very next verse. And many people should go and say, come ye and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord. So the body of Christ, God's throne, Mount Zion. Ye are coming to Mount Zion, unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, unto the spirits of just men made perfect, right? Unto the innumerable company of angels. To the house of the God of Jacob. So we get it again. The body of Christ. To the house of the God of Jacob. So come ye and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, Mount Zion, the body of Christ, the throne, which is the house of the God of Jacob, which is Jerusalem, which is the body of Christ, right? So we absolutely, for me, get it there. But get this, and he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his paths, for out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. And Luke 8 and verse 5, a sower went out to sow his seed. Verse 11 tells us that seed is the word of God. That on the good ground, for me, are the body of Christ. They are Jerusalem. So we're getting the word of the Lord going from Jerusalem, and out of Zion shall go forth the law. So from out of the throne shall go forth the law, and the word of the Lord shall go forth from Jerusalem. Here I'm seeing Jerusalem, they're receiving the word of God. Back in John 17, where we read of the body of Christ becoming one in one another, Jerusalem. As the Lord Jesus Christ are one, we're going to become one with one another, and we're going to become one with the Lord Jesus Christ and the Father. So the body of Christ have received the word of God. So Jerusalem have received the word of the Lord. Neither I pray for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me. So the body of Christ members that are still to be grafted in by their word. So the word of the body of Christ. As we draw other believers to the body of Christ, they're going to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ through their word. Through whose word? They who've received the seed on the good ground, the body of Christ. So for me, that's what we're getting here. The word of the Lord will go from Jerusalem. Isaiah 8:18. Behold, I and the children whom the Lord hath given me are for signs and wonders in Israel from the Lord of hosts, the Lord of the celestial bodies, which dwelleth in Mount Zion. So heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. The Lord dwells in Mount Zion. This is what I say before. He's omnipresent, but the scriptures is making a point of it here that that's where God dwells. God dwells in Mount Zion. God dwells in the body of Christ, which is the Lord's house, the house of the God of Jacob, which is the throne, which is the body of Christ. And that's where God dwells now. That house of the Lord, that house of the God of Jacob, the dwelling place of God through the Spirit that we read in Ephesians and 1 Peter. And Isaiah 10:12, wherefore it shall come to pass that when the Lord hath performed his whole work, right? So looking to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Philippians 1:6, he that started this will have got that confidence that he's going to finish it, the finished work, right? Wherefore it shall come to pass that when the Lord has performed his whole work upon Mount Zion and on Jerusalem. So who's the Lord performing his work on? The body of Christ. And that's what we get here. So for me, it's as close as we can get to naming to me Mount Zion is actually the body of Christ. It's as close as that, right? And I don't want the truth to be anything. I'm just putting down why every single time I read these scriptures, particularly in the Old Testament, I just see this. And I'm just putting down why I'm being led to think it, right? Because I was down at the park and I was saying it and I thought, nah, I've got to establish. I've got to go through those scriptures and establish exactly why I'm being led to think these things. And Isaiah 10:32, and as yet shall he remain at Nob that day. So Nob, going on memory, it's got to do with the priests, just going on memory. And as yet shall he remain at Nob that day, he shall shake his hand against the mount of the daughter of Zion, the hill of Jerusalem. So the mount of the daughter of Zion is Mount Zion itself, which is it not heavenly Jerusalem that we read in Hebrews 12? Is this any different? For me, no way. It's exactly the same thing. So the daughter of Zion is the hill of Jerusalem and that mount. So that mount for me is Mount Zion. So Mount Zion is the mount of the daughter of Zion, which I'm seeing as the body of Christ as well, the hill of Jerusalem. So I'm seeing potentially the daughter of Zion could well be, it's like the sons of God. So as the sons of God, we become, it's hard, right? It's really, really hard because the body of Christ for me are the bride. And that's what I see here. We're all the collective daughters of Jerusalem, the daughter of Zion, but we're also the sons of God, right? Now, Isaiah, this one in Isaiah. So check this out. For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. So that tells me that Lucifer has his own throne, because he's not going to be saying in his heart that he's going to exalt his throne that doesn't exist. But that's possible, but I'm being led to think most certainly that Lucifer has his own throne. And it just totally makes sense as it pertains to Luke 1:52 that I'm going to get to in just a sec. But he's going to exalt his throne above the stars of God. The celestial body of Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ, we see right through in the scriptures. That mysterious man in Daniel 10, for instance. All the voices, thunderings and lightnings that are coming out of the throne. And all of those voices that were being manifest in the Old Testament, the body of Christ, right through the Old Testament. For me, they're the stars of God. It could even be pertaining to the prophets. And we'll sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. So I will also, so he's going to exalt his throne above the stars of God, and he's also going to, upon the mount of the congregation, he's going to sit also upon the mount of the congregation. So is this saying that he's actually going to, he's claiming that he's going to sit upon God's throne, that being Mount Zion, and rule over the body of Christ? That's how this reads to me. Now, Isaiah, we could go on all day, right? All day to a place of the name of the Lord of the celestial bodies, the Mount Zion. It's just, that one's interesting. I talk about this one quite a bit. Then the moon shall be confounded and the sun ashamed when the Lord of hosts shall reign in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem and before his ancients gloriously. So does God reign just in Mount Zion and his throne, or is Mount Zion actually the throne? You can see why I'm being led to think these things. Now, it really hots up when we come down to the later part of Isaiah. As I say, you could go through Isaiah all day with this word mountain. But check this one out in Isaiah 56, 7. Even them will I bring to my holy mountain. Who? The body of Christ, right? Even them will I bring to my holy mountain. So what's his holy mountain? For me, it's Mount Zion and the throne. Now I'll get to that in just a sec, because remembering the Lord Jesus Christ in the prayer says we are all going to become one. As in each other, and God and the Lord Jesus Christ are one, and we're going to become one in them, and he's going to bring us to his holy mountain. So we're going to be one with that holy mountain, one with God, one with the throne, one with Mount Zion. And make them joyful in my house of prayer. My house, right? So the Lord God's house, the Holy Spirit's house, is us as the body of Christ, as individuals and as a collective, as we become one in the unity of the Spirit, in the unity of the faith. And that's the house of his prayer. That's what we're getting here. This is the body of Christ. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon mine altar, and my house shall be called a house of prayer for all people. So that's what the body of Christ is, right? We worship the Holy Spirit and we're the house of prayer. Isaiah 56, 13. When thou criest, let thy companies deliver thee, but the wind shall carry them all away. Vanity shall take them, but he that putteth his trust in me, the body of Christ, there's nobody else. If you do this, you're a part of the body of Christ. If you don't do this, you're not a part of the body of Christ. There's no difference. He that putteth his trust in me shall possess the land. Right? Shall possess the land. So the land for me is the farm. The land for me is the house. We've all got our own brick in the house, our office. We've all got our own field in the farm, and we're going to possess it. It's going to be ours as joint heirs with the Lord Jesus Christ, and shall inherit my holy mountain. So there it is, right? So if I'm in truth here, this is why this is so significant, and this is why I felt absolutely compelled to do a video on this. If I'm in truth, which I'm growing in more and more of the view, and even confidence that I am, if I'm in truth here, what we're actually seeing here is the body of Christ are actually going to inherit Zion and the throne. So we come back to these scriptures, right? This is what I pointed to before. So in John 17, the prayer is that the body of Christ all become one, as thou, Father, art in me and I in thee, that they also may become one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. So we're becoming one. The Lord Jesus Christ and the Father are one, and we're going to become one in them. So if we become one in them, we're becoming one with the Father. Are we not? Are we not? So we come back to this scripture. We're all one. He that putteth his trust in me shall possess the land and shall inherit my holy mountain, because we're all one. So whatever God has, God's sharing it with us. That's what I'm saying. This is why I have to start putting this down now, because this is the two things now are connecting. The sons of God, the promises, and Mount Zion being the body of Christ and the throne. It's all for me. It's all starting to run the same. It's the same thing. So this is the body of Christ shall possess the land and shall inherit my holy mountain, as we become one in each other. The Lord Jesus Christ and the Father one with each other, and we're all going to become one as a collective. We've come to the unity of the faith. This is the house of God. This is the house of prayer, the Holy Spirit dwelling within us, and they may be one in us, and we're going to inherit the holy mountain, that being the throne, that being Mount Zion. And that's that scripture we read earlier in Isaiah. Was it Isaiah? Yeah, that one there in Isaiah 10. Wherefore it shall come to pass that when the Lord hath performed his whole work upon Mount Zion and on Jerusalem, I will punish the fruit of the stout heart and of the king of Assyria and the glory of his high looks. Now, this is what I was putting down at the part. So I'm seeing Galatians 5 in this, the old out and the new. So when the Lord has performed the progression of faith upon the body of Christ, I will punish the fruit of the stout heart of the king of Assyria, because the king of Assyria is the king of the unclean spirits that used to dwell in our land. But due to the progression of faith, the finished work, when the Lord's finished that thing, being confident he'll finish that thing, looking to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, he's going to punish the fruit of the. So he's going to punish those unclean spirits that were in us. So the Holy Spirits move in as the unclean spirits move out. So it's the end work. It's the end of it all. And that's what I'm seeing here in Isaiah 57:13. So he that putteth his trust in, it's the same thing, right? In me shall possess the land. So this is the land, this is the farm, this is Zion, this is where the Holy Spirits dwell in our field, because the stout heart of the king of Assyria has now been purged out. Now, this for me shall inherit my holy mountain. My holy mountain. So this for me are they that overcome, is it not? Those that overcome shall inherit my holy mountain. So does God have a holy mountain and a throne? Or is it all pointing to the same thing? For me, as I've been putting down, it absolutely points to the same thing. Because we're all going to be made one with one another. The Lord Jesus Christ and the Father are one, and we're going to become one in them, that they may be one, even as we are one, that they may become one in us. I keep coming back to this because this is just so significant for me. This is enormously significant, because this for me is saying that whatever the relationship the Lord Jesus Christ has with God, that's the relationship we're going to have with God. Every single thing that the Lord Jesus Christ has, the body of Christ are going to have, and the Lord Jesus Christ is God. That's what I'm saying. So John 16, these things I have spoken unto thee, you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation. Be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. So the accusation of fact to the Lord Jesus Christ, when he responds with, "I, you're gods, that it's in your law, you're gods too." Because he, as being a man, by saying God was his father, made himself in fact God. And the Lord Jesus Christ will say, it says in the law, you're gods too, right? And that's what Revelation 21's telling us. That they that overcome shall inherit all things, I will be his God, and he shall be my son. So if God is your God, so whoever your God is, he's your father and you're his son. Brothers or sisters, you're his son, right? So that's what the Lord Jesus Christ was saying about the Pharisees, because the Pharisees, they worship the devil. That's what they do. So the devil's their father. He's their father, right? So our God is Jehovah, the Holy Spirit, and we're going to be his sons, the sons of God, right? And we're all going to become one with God. He that overcometh shall inherit all things. And that's what we're getting in Isaiah 57 for me. He that putteth his trust in me shall possess the land and shall inherit my holy mountain, as we inherit all things, because we're inheriting the throne, right? We're inheriting the throne. We're inheriting Mount Zion as the body of Christ, becomes that. Because we're all becoming one. For me, it's just, it's here, right? That's what's going on here. So in 1 John 5, whosoever is born of God overcometh the world. This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. And he that overcometh the world is he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God. And we also, of course, get that the Lord Jesus Christ tells us, be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. So to him that overcometh in Revelation 3, will I grant to sit with me in my throne. So we're going to sit with the Lord Jesus Christ in his throne as we become one in him, and he's sitting upon the throne of his Father as he becomes one with his Father, as we all become one with one another, as we inherit all things, as God becomes our Father. I have said, ye are gods, and those that trust in him shall possess the land and shall inherit my holy mountain. Zion, right? The land, the building, the body of Christ, we're going to inherit all things. Now, finishing out where we see this Hebrew word H2022 for mountains in Isaiah. When thou didst terrible things, which we looked not for, thou comest down, the mountains flow down at thy presence. Your iniquities and the iniquities of your fathers together, saith the Lord, which have burnt incense. So for me, that pertains to worship upon the mountains, and blaspheme me upon the hills. Therefore will I measure their former work into their bosom. So this for me is going to mountain worship. So the abode of the deities, the abode of the gods, because they're worshipping the whole host of heaven. And that's what I see here. They're actually worshipping the mountain of the unclean spirits. But get this, right? I will bring forth a seed out of Jacob, right? So the seed of Abraham, the seed of Christ. This is the body of Christ. I will bring forth a seed out of Jacob and out of Judah, an inheritor of my mountains. Check this out. And mine elect shall inherit it, and my servants shall dwell there. Okay, so mine elect is the body of Christ. They're going to inherit my mountains, right? Plural mountains. Now, I'll just touch on it now, because I'm going to have a look at this in a bit more detail in just a bit. This Greek word, G2362, for throne. So we've got the Son of Man. He's going to sit in the throne of his glory. In Revelation 3, to him that overcometh, I will grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcome and have sat down with my Father in his throne. So Jesus has his own throne, but he's also sitting upon his Father's throne. And we're getting the Lord Jesus Christ. He's going to sit in the throne of his glory. But those who are inheriting the mountains, the seed of Jacob, the body of Christ, the Lord God's elect, they're going to sit upon 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. So the Lord Jesus Christ has his own throne. He's sitting upon his throne, but he's also sitting down with the Father in his throne. The body of Christ, the inheritor of the mountains, are going to sit upon the multiple thrones, the multiple mountains, with the Lord Jesus Christ as he sits upon his throne, right? That's what we're getting here. The Lord Jesus Christ, we're going to sit with him in his throne. But we're also going to be sitting upon our own thrones, one for each tribe, but we're going to sit upon the throne of the Lord Jesus Christ as the Lord Jesus Christ sits upon the throne of the Father, as we who overcome the world, who are inheriting the thrones, the mountains, we're becoming one with one another as the Lord Jesus Christ is one with the Father, and we become one with the Lord Jesus Christ and the Father. So it tells me that we're going to be sitting upon the 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel, as the Lord Jesus Christ sits upon his throne. We're going to sit upon his throne, and we're also going to sit upon the throne of the Father, and we're going to be the inheritor of these mountains. and we're going to be the inheritor of my holy mountain. So this is a singular, right? So the body of Christ, he that trusts in the Lord God shall possess the land and shall inherit his singular holy mountain, Mount Zion, the throne. The seed of Jacob, the body of Christ, the Holy Spirit's elect, is an inheritor of the multiple mountains. We're going to sit upon the 12 thrones. As the Lord Jesus Christ sits upon the throne of his glory, and the Lord Jesus Christ is sitting upon that one singular throne with the Father, and we're going to sit down with him upon his throne. So that's combining these thrones for me here, and we're all going to become one as we inherit Mount Zion, the throne, right? For me, that's what I'm seeing. And I see that it all comes together in Revelation 21, verse 7, and Revelation 3. And it all ties into it. I've been putting these down, right? I think I've stated my case for now with what I'm seeing here in this screenshot, because that for me is what's going on. We all become one, and we're going to inherit. We're all going to be sitting upon the throne of God, that being Mount Zion. That's the glory. That's the Lord's glory, the body of Christ. So it's absolutely significant, man. It is absolutely, absolutely significant, this. So I want to bring this one in. It's really hard to know what order to do all this at the moment, because I've got so many scriptures here. It's really hard, but we're just going to plow on. So I wanted to bring this one in Revelation 7, because this is very, very interesting indeed. So we've got the angels standing about the throne. They're standing about the throne, right? So the heavenly body of Christ. And about the elders and the four beasts fell before the throne on their faces and worshiped God, saying, Amen. So they're around about the throne. Is this Zion? I'm being led to think this is Zion. This is Eden as well. This is in fact paradise. Now they're round about the throne. So are they a part of the throne? Around about the throne, right? The body of Christ. And the elders and the four beasts fell before the throne on their faces and worshiped God, saying, Amen, blessing, glory, wisdom, and thanksgiving, and honor and power, and might be unto our God forever and ever, right? So he's their God, right? So if he's their God, they're his sons, right? So these are the sons of God. These are the body of Christ in heaven. And one of the elders answered, saying unto me, What are these which are arrayed with these white robes, and whence come they? Now, this is very mysterious to me, because we've got this great multitude. We've got this great multitude. Now, when I first see this on the surface, I'm led to think this is what we're getting here back in Hebrews 12, where we come into Mount Zion, into the innumerable company of angels, right? But there's more to consider here, because we get that they have actually come out of the great tribulation, right? They've come out of the great tribulation. Now, the Lord Jesus Christ says in Matthew 7 that there's not going to be a lot of people that go on that narrow path to go through that straight gate. There's not going to be a lot. So who are these that have actually come out of the great tribulation? I don't know, because there's a great multitude. And they're clothed with white robes. So for me, they've gone through the progression of faith, because there's been a great tribulation, and they've now reached the outcome of the progression of faith, because they're now in white. And once you're in white, that's it. You've made it. And that's who these are. So this is after the 144,000 are first spoken about in Revelation 7. And that reminds me too, don't hurt. There was a scripture we just shared in Isaiah, but I've got to try and stay on track. And then it was after this, lo, I beheld a great multitude. So whether the great multitude are in fact the 144,000, it's hard to know, because John isn't saying here that he's actually seeing them. He's heard who they were sealed. So he's just heard it. He's heard that there's 144,000 sealed. So it's possible after he heard who's getting sealed, it's possible that after this he then beheld that great multitude who's been sealed. Because a great multitude, it's hard to know, right? Because I think about it now and I think, well, okay, so they reckon now upon planet Babylon there's like 7 billion people. Now, if there's 144,000 at the end, if the 144,000 are in fact those who are left standing at the end who haven't taken the mark of the beast, well, then I think about that upon planet Babylon now, and you think, you do a little bit of quick mass and calculated on that mass, you've got about one in every 48,000, 50,000 so people are actually of the 144,000. You consider that and you think, well, one in 50,000 people are actually the 144,000. Now, 144,000, would that be considered a great multitude? Potentially, right? 144,000. You see 144,000 now, they can't, like the biggest stadiums in the world, that wouldn't contain that amount of people. So it could pertain to that, because when we relate it to the earth today, 144,000 is nothing. It's like one in 50,000, right? But so that's who these could be pertaining to. I don't know, but it's very interesting because that they've come out of this great tribulation and they've washed their robes. So they've been through the progression of faith. But in any case, get this. Therefore are they before the throne of God. So they're before the throne of God. So this is the thing here, right? So we've got these angels. They're also standing around about the throne. And in fact, it was Revelation 4 for memory. We come back. This is how it's described. So we've got out of the throne proceeded lightning, thunders, and voices, and there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God, right? Now, those seven spirits of God, of course, we read this in Revelation 5 and in Zechariah, but those seven spirits of God are the seven eyes of the slain lamb. That's the seven spirits of God that have been sent forth into all the earth. But they're standing before the throne. Well, they're burning before the throne, right? And that's what I say. When we come back to Revelation 7, we've got the angels there standing round about the throne, and we've got these that have come out of the great tribulation there before the throne of God. So it's the same as the Lord Jesus Christ, right? So for me, they're on the throne. They're a part of the throne. The throne's actually the body of Christ. That's how I'm seeing it. God's throne, his glory, where he dwells. He dwells on his throne. He dwells in Zion, and he dwells in the body of Christ. And they are they that before the throne of God. Now, they serve him day and night in his temple. So for me, that's just epically huge as well, right? Because his temple is the body of Christ, is us. So we are serving God right now in his temple, are we not? Because our bodies now belong to him. We belong to him and his body, the body of Christ. So we're serving him day and night in his temple, and they're standing before the throne of God. And he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. And that's what's happening now. There's some scriptures I'm about to share that pertain to all this, but we know those scriptures by now, that the Holy Spirit, our bodies, is a habitation for the Holy Spirit in us. And that throne shall dwell among them. Because we are that throne. We are Zion. That's what this is for me. And as I say, that's what I see here in Hebrews 12. So Mount Zion, the city of the living God. So that for me is who these are that have come out of this great tribulation. Whoever they are, whether they're 144,000 or someone else, I don't know. But they've come out of this great tribulation and they're now wearing these white robes. They've come unto Mount Zion, which is the throne of God. They're serving him day and night. And they've come into Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem, to these innumerable company of angels. Those that have come out of this great tribulation, this great multitude, and we've got angels standing about the throne, the great multitude. We've got these angels standing about the throne. So this great multitude, for me, have come into the angels. They've come into Mount Zion, the throne, and into the innumerable company of angels. It's pertaining to the same thing, right? So they've come into Mount Zion, which is in fact the throne of God. And unto the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and unto the innumerable company of angels. To the general assembly and church of the firstborn, right? So the firstborn among many brethren, which are written in heaven, and to God the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect, because they've come out of the great tribulation, and they've got their robes have been washed clean due to the progression of faith. But they've also come to Jesus, right? They've also come to Jesus. So Jesus is sitting upon his throne. He's sitting upon the throne of the Father. We're going to sit upon those 12 thrones. We're going to sit upon the throne of Jesus as he sits upon the throne of Zion. And that's where the body of Christ are going to be sitting, upon Mount Zion, upon the throne. When we see this word inherit in Revelation 21:7 and Isaiah 57:13, I ask ye, what thinketh ye when you see this English word inherit? What's your understanding of this word inherit? So I thought I'd come to Planet Babylon and have a look. So this is my understanding. To receive money, property, or a title as an heir at the death of the previous holder. She inherited a fortune from her father. Derive a quality characteristic or predisposition genetically from one's parents or ancestors. So that's my understanding of the word. When we apply it to these scriptures, inherit my holy mountain and inherit all things. So this in Revelation 21:7 doesn't say some things. You're going to inherit a lot of stuff except this. It says all. It says all, right? So inherit all things. So there's nothing that the body of Christ are not going to inherit. I see this word and I think, well, okay, derive a quality characteristic or predisposition genetically from one's parents or ancestors. So that for me goes to the progression of faith. As we continue, because Jerusalem, our mother, means teaching of peace. And the Holy Spirit, we're becoming one with him. Mankind becoming one again with the Father, back into the image of God, the restitution of all things. So that would pertain to that. But it's also to receive from your parents, right? So when your parents die, you share it with your siblings, but you receive it all. You receive the inheritance. Now, potentially, when you receive that inheritance on the earth today, you don't receive everything. But in Revelation, it clearly says, inherit all things. So your parents' estate, everything that they own, you actually inherit, but it has to happen at their death. It has to happen at their death. Now, God's not going to die, right? But God did die because the Lord Jesus Christ died carnally. But this for me is, it's future dated. So it's a difficult one. But I see the word inherit means everything that they have, you're now going to possess. That's my understanding. So we have a look at the Hebrew word, H3423. Just going to touch on all this now because what I've decided to do, it's now be the next day. It's the Friday now. It's the 22nd of July. It's around about 2 o'clock in the afternoon here on the New South Wales Central Coast. What I've decided to do is just do a little bit more on this now and then wind it up because I'm coming up to 2 hours already and I've still got a whole heap more I want to go through. And as I go through this video now, I'm seeing more And my mind, my memory is also getting jolted about certain scriptures that I had forgotten about as it pertains to this that I simply must put down. So I'm just going to touch on a couple of things now and then start off on a fresh video. We're going to talk about that in a bit more as I finish this out. So we get it the 232 times and possess, inherit, heir, possession, succeed, dispossess, poverty, drive, enjoy, poor, expel utterly, and we get the 11 miscellaneous. So we get both there. We get to take your inheritance away, but also to receive your inheritance. And that's what I'm focusing on here, because we're going to receive. We're not going to have it taken away. To seize, dispossess, to take possession of, inherit, disinherit, occupy, impoverish, be an heir. To take possession of, right? To inherit, to impoverish, come to poverty, be poor. So it's pertaining to taking possession. That's what the children of Israel did in Joshua. They took possession of their lots. So that, what were they, we've got to stay on track. What were they doing then? What were they taking possession of? The land. So I've got to stay on track. So I see it as you're going to take possession of it. You're going to inherit it. It's now going to be yours. So we come into the New Testament. He that overcometh shall inherit all things. Now this becomes big, this term, the kingdom of God. And I do intend getting back to it in just a sec. The kingdom of God. Because we see it here the four times. Inherit the kingdom of God. Now we get this one the 18 times. Inherit, be heir, obtain by inheritance. To receive a lot, to receive by lot. So it's just like the Old Testament in the book of Joshua when they were receiving their field on the farm. To receive a part of an inheritance, receives as an inheritance obtained by the right of inheritance. To be an heir, to inherit. To be an heir. So the Lord Jesus Christ is the heir, and we're now joint heirs. And we're going to, this is what this scripture says in Revelation, this for me is absolutely key, shall inherit all things. Not some, not this, not that, but all. Everything. Everything that God has, the body of Christ, are going to inherit. Now, God's not going to be no longer the owner. We're co-heirs with the Lord Jesus Christ. As we all become one. That's what I'm seeing here. So the body of Christ inherit all things. God's not giving them away. He's sharing them as we all become one. I really, really want to do this video now on the Godhead, but I feel I could be on this one for quite a while, a couple of videos at least, and I may be doing a part video, but I'll get to all that in just a sec. Just stay on track, Brett. Come on, mate. You need to stay on track. So shall inherit all things. And this word, again, we get it the 18 times. To be an heir, to inherit all things. To receive the portion assigned to one, receive an allotted portion, receive as one's own or as a possession, to become a partaker of, to obtain, to receive, to get all things. Everything the Lord Jesus Christ has inherited, everything that God has, all things, the body of Christ are going to inherit, are going to receive. That's what I'm saying. Now, I thought I'd come into Isaiah 57 in just a little bit, just to have a look at it, just a little bit more detail. Not a huge amount, just a little bit more detail. So these are the scriptures that I think most people see when they first start waking up, where they poke out their tongues. And that's what they all do on the earth today, don't they? And they're a seed of falsehood. In verse 7, upon a lofty and high mountain, thou hast set thy bed, even thither wentest thou up to offer sacrifice. Now, I read this, and they're not going to the top of Mount Everest and killing a cow, a goat, or a sheep. It's not about that. These are these creatures running the world today, poking out their tongue, and they're upon a lofty and high mountain. That's where they've set their bed, so they're not just retiring for the evening. even thither wentest thou up to offer sacrifice. So it's not what it appears to be on the surface when we read these words carnally. It's something else, a high and lofty mountain. I'm seeing this that they went up to a high throne. Now we've got Lucifer saying he's going to exalt his throne above the stars of God. Are we potentially seeing some sort of connection there? I don't know, potentially. But when we look in the scriptures that I've been sharing, this one in verse 13, and I'm just going to share the two after it as well. When thou criest, let thy companies deliver thee, but when the wind shall carry them all away, vanity shall take them. But he that putteth his trust in me shall possess the land and shall inherit my holy mountain. Now we come back to this Greek word G2816 for inherit. And this is what I say. We see this term kingdom of God four times. So the Lord Jesus Christ says, blessed the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. So the body of Christ are going to inherit the earth. It's very, very interesting indeed, because there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth. But we get this term the kingdom of God, right? So 1 Corinthians 6:9. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, and be not all of that. Don't have those unclean spirits dwelling in you. So the unrighteous are not going to inherit the kingdom of God. The body of Christ are going to inherit all things and my holy mountain, the kingdom of God. Now the Lord Jesus Christ says that the kingdom of God, it dwells within us. It dwells within us. But I see this as most certainly that, but it's also future. It's also the future. It's eternal life. It's this. For me, the kingdom of God, it's within now, absolutely. But the kingdom of God is actually eternal life. That's the holy mountain for me. Shall possess the land. So that's for me, that's Zion, and shall inherit my holy mountain, which is also Zion. So the body of Christ is the land. Mount Zion, for me, is also the body of Christ. Everything I see here, it's all pointing to the same thing. The body of Christ, Zion, and the throne. It's all pertaining to the same thing. Now, we're going to inherit my holy mountain. So the Holy Spirit's the Lord God's holy mountain. Shall possess the land and inherit my holy mountain. And we're also going to inherit the kingdom of God. And we get it another couple of times. It's pertaining to the same thing in verse 10. And it's these are the things that are not going to inherit. They're not going to inherit the kingdom of God. Now, this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. So for me, this goes to the progression of faith and that it's absolutely future dated. And we get it again. It's talking about Galatians 5, right? Galatians 5, this is absolutely talking about the progression of faith. So the kingdom of God, I most certainly am seeing that it's pertaining to the land and the holy mountain, and it's actually the body of Christ. So we're the members of the body of Christ, but the actual body of Christ is an inheritance, the bread, which is the land that we all till, and we've all been blessed to be given a parcel of field, a brick in that house, a parcel of field in that land, and a brick in that house. So that's the inheritance, shall inherit the land and inherit my holy mountain, which is actually the body of Christ. And we're members of the body of Christ now, but we need to continue so that this inheritance actually takes place at the last day. That's what I'm being led to think. And shall say, cast ye up, prepare the way, take the stumbling block out of the way of my people. So that's a lack of faith for me. For thus saith, and I see this potentially as celestial scriptures as well, because cast up, you get it in Isaiah 62 from memory, where it's the same Hebrew word as the stars falling their courses against Sisera. For thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, right? So the high and lofty one But they've gone and upon a high and lofty mountain. But the Holy Spirit, the Lord God, is the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy place. So what's that? With him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit. So the babes in Christ who have humbled themselves before the Lord, he's going to exalt them of a low degree to revive the spirit of the humble. Ye have come into Mount Zion, the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to the innumerable company of angels, unto the spirits, the church of the firstborn, and unto the spirits of just men made perfect. The humble spirit and the spirit of the humble, and will revive the heart of the contrite one. So we're going to be given that new heart, right? The inheritance. The inheritance. The body of Christ are going to inherit all things, my holy mountain. Here in Matthew 21, we get in verse 43, I say unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to a nation, bringing forth the fruits thereof. So they had it. In the Old Testament, the children of Israel, they had the kingdom of God. They had it. Because in order for it to be taken away, they had to have it, right? So they had the kingdom of God. In Jeremiah 32, for me, we get that we're going into the same land. It's the same land. The body of Christ are going into that same land that the children of Israel had here in the Old Testament. So they had the inheritance, but due to sin, that stumbling block, lack of faith, it's going to be taken away from them. And that's what we get. I will make an everlasting covenant with them. I will put fear in their hearts. And we read in Ezekiel, of course, we're going to be given the new heart. That's that heart of flesh. And that's what we're getting here, to revive the heart of the contrite ones, right? The body of Christ getting the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God. And this is the thing. This is that term, kingdom of God, again. This is that inheritance that I've been talking about. So the inheritance in Isaiah 57 is my holy mountain and the land. So the children of Israel in the Old Testament, they had that inheritance, the kingdom of God. That's what we get. The kingdom of God. Inherit. We're going to inherit the kingdom of God, and they're having the kingdom of God taken away from them. That kingdom of God is the land, this land, the everlasting covenant, this place, the house. The house of God, right? So this for me is Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem, is it not? Because we're coming into Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem, and we're going to inherit that very same land. It's not a little slither of land that they call, well, that's the modern day land of the little hat. It's not that. It's not that. It's the heavenly Jerusalem. It's Mount Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem. And that's what it is. The kingdom of God, yes, it dwells within us, but that's the inheritance. The inheritance is the kingdom of God, and that's the land. And that's the holy mountain, which for me is the throne, the actual body of Christ. Yeah, we're a collective of people, but the actual body of Christ is glorious because it's the Lord Jesus Christ's body. So it has to be glorious, right? Because it's actually his body. So that we inherit the actual body of Christ, that's just absolutely glorious to think about, is it not? So the body of Christ are going to be, of course, the body of Christ are going to be exalted. The more I think about it, the more it's just logical, because it's Christ's body. How can it be anything else but glorious? And the body of Christ is the land, which I'm strongly being led to think is Zion, the holy mountain, and it's the throne, because we all become one, right? So we're all going, it is the same land, the kingdom of God, which is the inheritance, which is being given to a nation bringing forth the fruits thereof, and that's the church, the body of Christ, Jew and Gentile. That stumbling stone's been taken out of the way, that being the stumbling stone of faith. And this is another thing I want to talk about, potentially going to do a park video next, I don't know, just about faith. The whole thing right through has just been about faith. I've had a big morning in the scriptures. But it's exactly how I've titled this. The land is the farm and the house, which is the body of Christ. And now I'm seeing that it's all also the throne and it's Zion. And that's what we're getting here. Shall inherit my holy mountain and the land. The land is the body of Christ. The holy mountain is the throne and it's Zion. It's all the same thing, right? I'm just at fever pitch and I've got so many more scriptures to go on this. It isn't funny, and that's why I've decided to wind it up here today. But I just want to touch on these ones now. Like, check this out, right? So I see Deuteronomy 3:25 potentially as the Garden of Eden. And this is, I'll just touch on this now, actually, because just to give it some context as to what I'm actually talking about here. So in Genesis 2, we've got a river going out of Eden. In Ezekiel 47, we've got waters issuing out from under the threshold of the house. And in Revelation 22, we've got, I'm being absolutely strongly led to think, fever pitch being led to think, pretty well settled, we've got the same water proceeding out of the throne of God. So it's the same water coming out of the throne, coming out of the house, and coming out of Eden. So I'm now seeing that Eden absolutely is paradise. Eden is absolutely the throne. Eden is absolutely Zion. And I'm also seeing it as the body of Christ as well. But it's difficult to correlate that particular part of it in here. But we all become one. For me, that's the key to all this, is that we all become one. So it's the same water coming forth out of Eden, the throne, and the house. And that's what I'm seeing here in Deuteronomy 3:25, that goodly mountain is, in fact, it's the same thing. This is the Garden of Eden. This is Zion. This is paradise. This is the throne. It's the same thing. But in Isaiah 14, so for me, we've got Lucifer. This is, it's hard, right? But yeah, I am absolutely being led to think that Lucifer has his own throne, his own mountain. And that's what he's saying, he's actually going to exalt it. And that's what we're getting, aren't we? That's what we're getting back here in Isaiah 57. For me, that's it there. This is the throne of Lucifer, that these seed of falsehood, that's what they're offering sacrifice to. And we've got Lucifer saying that he's going to exalt his throne. So I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation. So he's exalting his throne over the Holy Spirit's throne, Mount Zion. And for me, we're getting the two there. We've got the lofty and high mountain, and we've got the Holy Spirit. He's the high and lofty one who is on his mountain. And that's what Lucifer's saying here, that he's going to exalt his throne above God's throne. So he's got a throne, right? So Lucifer's got a throne for me. In Ezekiel 28, check this out. Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou was upon the holy mountain of God. So what's this? Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. I see these stones of fire as the stars of God. So Lucifer's going to exalt himself above the stars of God as he exalts his throne above the Holy Spirit's throne. And we've got the anointed cherub that covereth doing the same thing. But he's in the mountain of God, and he's walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. So for me, like the devil, Satan, in Job, he walks up and down in the earth. So he's going up and down. And for me, the anointed cherub that covereth is doing the same thing. He's walked up and down in the midst of the stones of the fire. So he's going up, back to the stones of fire, and then he's coming back down. And for me, the stones of fire are the stars of God. But he was upon the holy mountain of God. And in verse 16, we've got God telling him he's going to cast him out of the mountain of God. He's going to cast him out. And of course, when we come into Ezekiel 28, it's very interesting, right? Son of man, take up a lamentation for the king of Tyrus and say unto him, thus saith the Lord God, thou sealest up the sum full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. So he's been there, and we've got cherubim in the garden of Eden who are keeping the way of the tree of life. So they're guarding and protecting the moral fabric of life itself. This cherubim here, it's covering something. What's it covering? It's covering something as now, as this continues to come in, all of these things I've been working on, the Lord God, he dwelleth between the cherubims. That's where he dwells, on his throne, between the two cherubims. This cherubim covers something, and we've got cherubim in the Garden of Eden. Doesn't say how many, but we've got cherubim in the Garden of Eden who are keeping the way, keeping the moral fabric, watching, warding, guarding life, the moral fabric of life itself, the tree of life. Now, this cherubim, which is a celestial body, is covering something. This cherubim was upon the holy mountain of God. It's being booted out of the holy mountain of God, and it's been in Eden, the garden of God. Is there any difference? Is there any difference? And this is what I say. We come back into this screenshot that I've got here, that we've got the water coming out of Eden, out of the house, and out of the throne of God. It's the same water. For me, it's the same thing. The throne is the house, which is Eden, the Garden of Eden. And we've got this cherubim. It's been in Eden, the Garden of God, and it's been upon the holy mountain of God, because for me, it was potentially a member of the body of Christ in the Old Testament. It was dwelling in the house of God upon Mount Zion, in the throne, on the holy mountain, in the Garden of Eden. It's in the Garden of Eden, this thing. And it's being booted out. It is in the Garden of Eden, which I'm being strongly led to think is actually the throne. So the throne's been defiled for me. It's absolutely been defiled for me, and that's what I want to pick up in the next video. Just because now, because Zion had to be leveled, there was sin in Zion. I remember seeing a scripture about that. There's sinners in Zion. And it had to be leveled. Zion had to be leveled. And while there's no man in the land, the land's going to enjoy the Sabbath. It lay desolate. The land lay desolate. So that's the big thing for me now, is if I'm in truth here, and you can see dealing with the information, you can see, I hope and pray, not that I'm trying to convince anyone of anything, but I'm just putting down why I'm being led to think these things, why I'm being led to think these things, that the throne is actually Mount Zion. And if it's the case, well then the throne had to be, did God forsake his throne? Because Romans 7 tells me that God died. And he did. The Lord Jesus Christ is God, and he absolutely died. He died in the flesh. So everything had to be destroyed, everything. Just as the body of Christ are going to inherit all things. But we've got this anointed cherub that covereth. It's in the garden of God, and it's upon the holy mountain of God. So is there any difference? Is there any difference between Eden, paradise, Zion, the throne, and the body of Christ? Is there any difference? Because that's how I've been shifting my mind here today as I consider this, is the body of Christ. I'm shifting my mind from thinking the body of Christ is a collective of people on the earth today. That's true. That's what the body of Christ is. But the body of Christ is the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's glorious. It is absolutely and utterly glorious. The body of Christ. It's as glorious as the throne. It's as glorious as paradise and Eden because it's the Lord Jesus Christ's body. So is there any difference? I'm not seeing any at all. I'm going to finish out here at Revelation 21 where we read we've got a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth were passed away and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. So this, for me, is the body of Christ as a collective. Jerusalem. Now, Jerusalem's also our mother. So that's another layer of truth. That we as a collective are actually our mother. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. Now, the tabernacle of God, for me, is New Jerusalem, which is the body of Christ as a collective. So what we're seeing here is the body of Christ all becoming one with each other. We've become one with each other. We've come to the perfect unity of faith. And we've come to a perfect understanding of the knowledge of God and his will. That's where we are here. So the tabernacle of God is Jerusalem, which is the body of Christ, and he will dwell with them. So the building, right? And the dwelling place. The tabernacle of God is with men as we all become one, and he will dwell with them as we inherit all things and we become one with each other as the Lord Jesus Christ and God are one with each other as we become one with them. And the tabernacle of God, the house of God, is New Jerusalem, which is the bride. And the Holy Spirit, the Lord God, is going to dwell with us. He's going to do that on his throne, right? And this is Mount Zion. This is the heavenly Jerusalem. And this is a critical verse for me here, as I say about the throne. I make all things new. It's not some, but he makes all. He makes all things new. So it's not God. So there's something excluded from that. But it's talking about everything that's not God, right? We've got a new heaven. We've got a new earth and we've got a new Jerusalem. So we need a new Jerusalem. We need a new body of Christ because the old body of Christ was defiled and had to be destroyed. And that's what all of this is about. And he makes all things new. For me, I'm being led to think, including and especially the body of Christ, Zion, and his throne, because it had all become defiled due to sin. So that's where I'm gonna leave this one for now. Because I've still got a lot more scriptures that I want to share, man. I'd completely forgotten about Psalm 74 and Exodus 15, and I feel absolutely compelled to talk about those. Go have a look at Psalm 132 and then Psalm 99. It goes on and on this. It's just absolutely blowing my mind. Psalm 132 for me is where it all comes together, and these are the scriptures that I want to pick up on the maybe the next video. I don't know, because I'm thinking of a park video. The weather's okay out there at the moment. It's a bit warmer today, and I'm thinking it'd be quite a nice day out there today in the sunshine to be doing a park video. I'm thinking of doing a park video because I saw there this morning that God reveals the mystery. He's been revealing the mystery to his prophets all along. So for me, it was the body of Christ all along. The revelation of the mystery. I've seen a few things. I've seen a few things today in Corinthians and Romans, And it all goes back to a scripture I saw in Amos the other day. And I'm thinking, maybe a park video. I'm not sure, but I'm going to finish this out. I'm not going to stop with this. I want to do this. I want to do this properly. I was going to say now, but I did. The plan going in was to just outline just a few things. But now I'm growing in more and more of the view, so confidence, that I'm in truth here. I don't want to be confident of anything if it's not the truth. I just want to be confident of what the truth is. And for me, this is there. This is absolutely there. But I'm gonna finish this one here, because one of the reasons is I was just thinking before that I want to hear what people have got to say about this, because this is potentially quite controversial, and I understand that. I do completely understand that, and I've been really vexed as to whether I do it or not. But something that I've learned very, very quickly in my office here is that I just have to be brave. If I'm seeing it, I just have to be brave, collect the scriptures, be very, very deliberate about what I'm putting down and testing the scriptures whether these things are so. And I just felt compelled. I felt compelled to do it, this video. And I feel even more compelled now as I go on and on. But I want to hear what anybody's got to say. I'm very, very keen on some thoughts. And my last park video, it's very interesting. It's got a lot of views. Like for me, it's got a lot of views. It's got about 70 views. And please don't get me wrong. It's not about views and likes and making and just being popular. It's not about that. But I do want to edify brothers and sisters in the body of Christ. I feel as though it's a big part of my office to just discern those scriptures the best I possibly can, share what the Holy Spirit's showing me, so it may help people out there with their understanding of the scriptures. I feel very confident now in my heart that that's a big part. It's a big part of my office. But the last video, it's only been up for a couple of days, and it's already got about 70 views, and it's got 6 likes last I saw. And for me, and my videos, to get 6 likes on one video. And again, it's not about adulation, but I see a like. If you leave a like on my video, that tells me, because I don't get a lot of people commenting, and the people that I do get comments on, I feel utterly blessed that I do get any comments. Any comments I do get, I feel utterly blessed. But people that don't comment, when they leave a like, it tells me, oh, okay, they've got something from that. And it encourages me that I'm in truth. So to get 70 views and 6 likes in 2 days for me is quite a significant, it's proving to be quite a significant video, that last one down at the park. The reason I say all that is because, again, that was quite controversial, potentially what I was putting down, but I'm just seeing that people are getting edification from it. So I'm going to keep going, right? I'm absolutely going to keep going, but I do sense a park video. I don't know. I'm going to get this one up and just have a think about where to next. But that's it for now, right? There's a lot more to go. There is a lot more to go. Psalm 74, Psalm 99, Psalm 132, as we relate it all back to Exodus 15, bringing in Hebrews. It's Hebrews 8. A minister of the sanctuary and of the true tabernacle, which the Lord pitched, and not man. It's all pertaining to that for me. So that's the big thing now. The body of Christ is glorious. It has to be glorious because it's the Lord Jesus Christ's body. It's just at the moment, it's where his inhabitants, where that body right now, and we're going through it. We're going through the progression of faith, but we're absolutely going to be glorified with the Lord Jesus Christ. God's going to be glorified in us. It's not about our own glory, but God's going to be glorified in us because of our testimonies, the body of Christ. So the body of Christ is glorious. Zion's glorious. The throne's glorious. Paradise is glorious, and the Garden of Eden is glorious. And for me, paradise and the Garden of Eden, it's just perfect unity between God and man. Nothing between. Nothing between God and man. Perfect grace, perfectly watered, perfectly tilled land with the fruits of righteousness just up in abundance. man and God at perfect unity, and that's how the man was created. That's the restitution of all things, and that's the inheritance. Man and God all becoming one. For me, it's all just starting to make more and more sense. So that's where I'll potentially pick it up next video. Not sure. But anyway, I've rabbited it on enough. So anybody that's got anything out of this video, from the bottom of my heart, I do thank you for getting something out of it. It means the world to me to know that people are getting edification from my videos. As I've been saying in my last couple of videos, if you do disagree, that's fine. I welcome that, because we all just want the truth and we all just want edification as we build this glorious body of Christ in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. But if you do, I just ask that you deal with the information that I've provided, because there are plenty of occasions, as I've been putting down, where you think you're in truth and you see that one scripture that says something else. But that doesn't mean, when you see that one scripture that says something else, it just means that we don't yet understand. Well, from my point of view, I don't yet understand what that scripture actually means. But if I then throw out everything that I've learned and go with that scripture, well, then I've got to throw out that scripture, because I'm seeing everything that I've just thrown out and it can do your head in. So for me, it's about understanding what all of the scriptures mean, dealing with every single one of these scriptures. So just ask that. Disagreement's always welcome. Edification is absolutely, most certainly welcome. But I'd love to know what people think. I'd love to know what people think, because I feel as though now I'm talking about the heaviest things I've ever talked about since I've been doing those videos, man. It gets no heavier than what I'm seeing now and what I'm being led to think. And I'm just going to plow on. It's going to plow on, because for me, I ask every day, almost every day, that if I'm in truth, I ask for confirmations. If I'm in error, I ask for rebukes. It's interesting, actually. I got the little calendar, right? Little calendar today on Friday. Like, check this out. So I started out in Romans 8, and I got Romans 8:18, for I reckon the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. I got that today in the little calendar. The glory that shall be revealed in us, right? Because we're the body of Christ, the glory within us is the Holy Spirit, the kingdom of God that's dwelling within. And of course, the body of Christ are going to be glorious. Of course they are. It just makes sense that the body of Christ is glorious, because it's the body of Christ. It's the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. All right, my brothers and sisters, I have rabbited on for far too long, and I'll leave it there. And all the power and all the glory goes to the Lord Jesus Christ, our Saviour, woo, the King.
Heaven and earth will disappear, but my words remain forever. But no one knows the date and hour when the end will be, not even the angels, no, nor even God's Son. Only the Father knows. The world will be at ease, banquets and parties and weddings, just as it was in Noah's time before the sudden coming of the flood. People wouldn't believe what was going to happen until the flood actually arrived and took them all away. So shall my coming be. Two men will be working together in the fields, and one will be taken, the other left. Two women will be going about their household tasks, one will be taken, the other left. So be prepared, for you don't know what day your Lord is coming.
Life was filled with guns and war, and everyone got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready. Children died, the days grew cold, a piece of bread could buy a bag of gold. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind, the sun has come, you've been left behind. Thank you. ones left standing still. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come. You've been left behind. Life was filled with guns and war. You've been left behind.